So after the wonderful presentation by Hermann Einzel, this is a topic that I was asked to talk upon, is the real world issues related to infectious complications within the bispecific treatment era. So I think with each new class of agents, we are coming across with new classes of toxicities, and with such as the with bortezomib, with proteasome inhibitors, we have come across with neurotoxicity and cardiotoxicity. Now with the immunotherapies, we are facing new acute or late onset complications, and since the late onset complications involve infectious cytopenias and hypogammaglobulinemia, this is the topic that I would like to address briefly and leave more space for the discussion. And in the next slide, I will be talking about the. So the range of these complications are really very heterogeneous. Cytopenias may range between 40 to 90%. Lymphocytopenia, mainly CD4 counts. Exhaustion of lymphocytes, HLH, and hypogammaglobulinemia is likewise, and subsequently increased risk of infections is also in the same range. And everything depends on the drugs and the molecules, the way of treatment, and the baseline characteristics of these patients. That's why the incidence are such a within a such great range. And in the next slide, we will be comparing, looking at in detail across different agents. This shows a summary of different T cell directing agents, starting with teclistamab on the very left, elranatamab, the Regeneron product, the Celgene product, the AbbVie product, talquetamab in different two doses, and cevostamab. And the main comparison relies on the cytopenias, which is seen on the fourth row in incidence and in grade 3-4. You can notice that with teclistamab is in the 60% range, and with elranatamab, it's almost half of the patients. And it decreases with, for instance, with the regular product or the Celgene product, also with the AbbVie product, and goes up to 60% with talquetamab if it's given weekly, but when and drops to 30% rate when it is given biweekly. And lymphocytopenia is likewise is a frequent finding, but not as much as neutropenia. And this results with infections, and the infections in the grade 3-4 zone is around 40% in the first two anti-BCMA products, and goes down to around 30% with biweekly of talquetamab. And the usual belief and the phrases that with talquetamab, infectious problems are much less, and which can be also seen in the next slide, that BCMA versus non-BCMA, both the neutropenia and infections are different. The algorithm for CAR T associated myelosuppression has been published and well accepted. Everything is relies on the neutropenia, because that is the most relevant cytopenia adverse event that leads to infections. And responsiveness to G-CSF is the discriminator in terms of the decisions that follows later on. G-CSF responsive cytopenia is easy to handle, and also is associated with prophylactic approaches, including antifungal and also antiviral approaches. But those patients who are not responsive to G-CSF, that's a little complicated. And it also includes the baseline disease recurrence and MDS and multiple additional factors, and may lead even to stem cell transplant, either autologous or allogeneic. So this is a very well-known algorithm, so no need to go into deep details. But the other guideline, which has been published recently, the infections, the nature of the infections after the treatment, either the CAR T or bispecific, relies on the responsiveness. And during the first months, and with the myeloma burden, the infectious complications are high, and with gaining of response and recovery of the marrow, infectious morbidities become less. And there's a well-balanced distribution in terms of upper versus lower respiratory infections and also bloodstream infections. And fungal infections are not, this is a rule that you do not see it in the beginning very often, but it's a more later phase situation. And it is this has been seen, the trend for CAR T has been replicated for the bispecifics in the teclistamab study in Majestic 1. We see a decline in the rate of infections in time. And the conversion from each once weekly to every 2 weeks has made a dramatic impact on the frequency and the rate of the infections. And but this could be a matter of discussion. Why? Since increasing the interval may all have an impact on the blood levels, but on the other hand, it might be a bias. Because the conversion to every 2 weeks is a result of response, and so this could be two ways. And in the next slide, we are going to see the humoral immunity changes in the monumental study. So with talquetamab, similar to what has happened with the talquetamab, change in the although the if although once week 0.4 milligram per kilogram and compared with 0.8 milligram per kilogram, but instead every 2 weeks and the infectious problems are decreasing, so without a sacrifice from the efficacy. So this is another approach that can be used for protection. And here in the next slide, there is a graph which shows the CD19 positive B cells, which reflects the decrease in infectious morbidity to correlate with a better less toxic outcome. And in the next slide, you will be able to see in the monumental again in the anti-GPRCD platform the changes in the polyclonal immunoglobulin levels and corrected for the type of myeloma and also the corrected for the IV immunoglobulin administration. And with each subsequent cycle, we see that if it's given every week, the Ig levels are less compared to those patients who are given every 2 weeks. So, and this is a better approach, and we know that the efficacy is not hampered, and it is better to keep adherence to the treatment with this type of schedule. In the next slide, you will be able to see the value of immunoglobulin replacement. Of course, everything has a learning curve. In the beginning of bispecific therapy or T cell redirected therapy, we were not. This is traditional news that hypogammaglobulinemia can be corrected with IV immunoglobulin replacement. So this is a proof of concept that by correction we decrease the proportion of infections, and although it is not eliminated, but there's a certain major impact in correction of infections. And there is a beautiful review by the IMWG on how to approach infections, and one of the authors, Heinz, has written a beautiful review on infections in by IMWG, and also a more recent review on how to treat patients with bispecific agents. And this guideline contains, for instance, things that are routine, very well known and valid for other, such as the allogeneic transplant platform or other myeloma treatment. But there are more recent things such as herpes zoster vaccine. And this is something that we need to get used to if it is approved in the countries. And also, these data are mostly based on clinical trial data. And I think, well, my job in the next few slides, if we can continue, this is the guidance paper from the Hematologica, and also the one written by Heinz Ludwig, and also the recent IMWG paper. They all summarize how we should approach the side effects, including infections. So this is the real thing that I was asked to discuss. So, are there regional differences in access to prophylaxis and treatment for infections? In global, the country's GDP has an impact for access to medical facilities, but I think that's not only the issue. It's a matter of additional factors, including insurance coverage and many other things. And in terms of efficacy and toxicity, what we are facing today is we are having more potent treatments if we can have access to. CAR T is beyond the question, but for instance, bispecifics. Bispecifics are now approved in Europe and also in US, but the approval is expanding, but not worldwide. So there is limitation to access in the global way of looking. And on the other hand, we know that the toxicity issue has also limitations in terms of global regions. Why? In vivo or IV immunoglobulin replacement is a very costly approach. And this is not maybe covered for all countries and not for continuous use. So as long as we give the administer the bispecifics, there is a need for continuous use of these supportive cares. And the other issue is how to diagnose the infections. Infections are not only simple infections, not only bacterial infections, but there are viral and rare and complicated infections which required diagnostic approaches. And this needs to be done fast in real time to allow the patients to have the treatment immediately. On the other hand, CMV viremia is a topic which has not been solved in a conclusive manner. In the guidelines, it is stated that unless there is an organ involvement, a preemptive treatment of CMV viremia is not currently recommended. There is a need to have more experience to approach to treat by specific agents and to get accustomed to how to handle viremia in such settings. And there we have come across with different approaches for antifungal drugs, and there is a need for educational activity to disseminate the information that this is not an allogeneic transplant setting that requires routine antifungal treatments and relies on the duration of neutropenia and the additional diagnostic procedures. In the next slide, I would like to emphasize the importance of insurance coverage. Although some countries may have high GDP compared to other countries, insurance coverage may not be that homogeneous. And for this reason, access to both the bispecific and also the supportive care may not be optimal. When this is not an issue that can be covered here in a complete, but it's a matter of touching upon how this can be done. I think for future, what we need to do is to have more data from real world evidence, since in clinical trial data, patients are highly selected. And then patients with myelosuppression from the beginning or renal impaired patients are not included in clinical trials. And the data we capture regarding the infectious toxicities are not relevant for the real world data. So we are seeing more papers coming on real world evidence in terms of efficacy, but we need to see more data on the complications and in detail what type of infections, how successfully they are treated. And the last issue is regarding COVID, and we still have the COVID problem. Relevant today, we still have patients who are having COVID infections, and even patients on bispecific therapy, we haven't seen mortal outcomes. They seem to recover from it as long as their myeloma is not active. If it's under control, the intravenous immunoglobulins and other agents may be helpful. But the newer anti-COVID drugs are not also worldwide available. And patients who are progressing to an ICU point in those settings, for instance, in our country, we do not have the Pfizer drug available in our market. So that these are limitations which can be also valid for other countries. And I think in due time, we will have more experience how to handle. And we had early access program for elranatamab, which gave us the possibility to test advanced patients being treated outside of the clinical trial with these agents. And it is our problem to monitor infections and also to treat them properly. This is I this was not a very very hot topic, but I tried to complete the job I was assigned to. Thank you.